Hello, City Church. Welcome to our online service once again. I cannot believe that it's already the last Sunday in November. But you know, one of the ways to look at it is this way. This has been a tough year for many people, for the whole world, for that matter. But the Lord has sustained us this far. So we are so glad that you could join today. I want to encourage you to participate in the service. My mantra is always like, the more you put into the service, the more you engage into the service, the more you're going to get out of it. It's just the principles of giving and receiving. The more you engage with others, praying for needs you see, and also just reaching out and being an encouragement to others, you're going to get much more out of the service when you do that. So that's why I encourage you time and time again to do the same thing. If you're in the States, I hope that you had a wonderful Thanksgiving. And for those of you watching all across the world, we are so happy that you could join us today. God is good. He's good all the time. And even in 2020, He's a good God. So welcome to the service.
And kids, it's so great to see you here today. We are really excited because today on our City Kids Online, we're calling it Family Sunday. Mm-hmm. Because at Lincoln City Church in Lincoln, Nebraska, where we all meet, we have our fifth Sunday is Family Sunday, and a lot of our kids get to be in the service with their parents and worship together. And so today on our Kids Online, we decided to have all ages of kids enjoy one service together. And whether that means your kiddos are gathered together while you're engaging in the adult service, or you enjoy the kids' service later on with your kids all together, we invite you to just enjoy it today as we look at the fact that God's Word never fails. Mm-hmm. So be sure you check out that link below that says City Kids, because it'll take you right to a video. It'll take you to some family-geared activities together as we bring that point home today that God's Word never fails.
As we get ready for our offering today, I want to encourage you with a verse of scripture from 2 Corinthians chapter 9 and verse 10. It says this, it says, "For the God who supplies seeds to the sower and bread for food will also supply our store of seed and increase it." It goes on to say that we will be made rich in every way so that we can be generous in every occasion. And through us, your generosity will result in thanksgiving to God. The scripture is so encourages me in that God is the one who supplies our needs no matter what the situation. He's the one who initiated the first seed. That same God will supply for you and me no matter what environment, no matter what situation. We can put our trust in God no matter what's going on. But He gives us blessings so we can be a blessing. He says that we will be enriched in every way so that we can be generous in every occasion. So even through the pandemic, don't quit being generous. Don't stop giving, because through those hands, the Lord who supplies seed will continue to bless you and your family in every way. We have exciting giving opportunities coming up through Christmas. Be on the lookout for that, and we'll keep you posted. I want to pray over you right now. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your presence and in our lives. Thank you that you're a God who supplies all of our needs. As we've gone through this year, Lord, you have sustained us. And for many people, it's been a year of blessing. And others, it's been a year of many struggles. But yet, through this whole thing, you have remained faithful. and you promise to never leave us and to never forsake us. I pray your favor and open doors of blessing over your people today in every way. You know every need, you know every desire, you know every want. And I pray in Jesus' name, as you declared in the word we read, that you are the one who supplies seed to the sower. Open new opportunities and new seeds to be put in the hands of your people so that good work can be accomplished through their generosity. In Jesus' name, amen. And now it's my honor to welcome our speaker today, bringing the word to us, Pastor Dustin.
Hey, I'm so glad we can be here together again today. And I feel like the Lord really has a word for us today. And just take today, when we get into the Word, anytime we get into the Word, it's such an amazing thing because we know that God has something for us. And we should take those words and just go with what the Lord has for us and let it get into us and say, Lord, show me what you would have me to hear today. Listen with our ears today. Listen with our spirit today. And today our message comes really right from the very, very front of the Bible. We're going to start in Genesis chapter 1. And I just want to recap with you a little bit. You know, we have the 7 days of creation. And really over the first 5 days, you know, we see God pulling all things, all manner of things out of nowhere. And it's so amazing. And God said, you know, let there be light, and boom, there was light, and let there be night. And all of a sudden there was night, and the sun and the moon and the stars. And he just starts naming all of these things that are to be made, even the earth and the heavens. And all of a sudden those two separated. And then he said, even the fish in the sea and the birds of the air, he called them out and they were flying around and they were swimming. And then we get down to the sixth day. And this is where things get really interesting. So we're going to start today, Genesis chapter 1. Here we go, in verse 26. We're going to read all the way to 31 here. Starting at 26, it says, "Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle, over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth." And so God created man in his own image, and in the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. Then God blessed them, and God said to them, "Be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth." In verse 29, and God said, "See, I have given you every herb that yields seed, in which as on the face of the earth, and every tree whose fruit yields seed to you as food. Also to every beast on the earth, to every bird of the air, to everything that creeps in the earth in which there is life, I have given every green herb for food." And it was so. Then God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. So the evening and the morning were the sixth day. You know, before I go on, we're actually going to go into chapter 2 here in just a second. What is amazing, over the first 6 days, after God made these things, and he got to the end of his day, and he said, and the Lord looked at it, and he said, it was good. But he got to the sixth day, and something different. He created man, and he said, look, that is very good. I think that is awesome that he called us out above all other creation. He called out man and said, look what that creation right there is very good. It's so much more than all the other creations. Here we go in chapter 2, verse 7. And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living being. The Lord God planted a garden east of Eden, and there he put man whom he formed. And out of the ground the Lord made every tree grow that was pleasant to the sight and good for food. The tree of life was also in the midst of the garden, as well as the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Jump over to verse 15. And the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to tend and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, "Of every tree of the garden you may eat freely, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat it, you shall surely die." The Lord God said, "It is not good for man to be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him." And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every bird of the air and brought them to Adam to see what he would call them. And whatever Adam called him, each living creature, that was its name. So Adam gives names to the cattle, to the birds of the air, to every beast in the field. But for Adam, there was not found a helper that was comparable to him. And the Lord God then caused him to fall into a deep sleep, and he took from his ribs and he closed up his flesh in his place. Then the rib, which the Lord God had taken from man, he made it into a woman, and he brought her to the man. And Adam said, "Now this is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man." There's a lot to unpack in just that little bit of scripture. This is right at the very beginning of scripture. Imagine, I mean, as you dig into scripture, how much more is in there. But think about this, right at the very beginning. Let's start the beginning of all creation as it relates to creation itself, right? We know that God, again, I said it, God spoke all of these different things into existence. He started to form every animal, what? He says, out of the dust of the ground. Now, when he put them together, think about this. There was a lot that went into that, right? It wasn't just a matter of, okay, done. Well, no, God put a lot of detail and a lot of thought into every single animal that he was forming. Think about that. He came down to earth, and even you think about cattle and some of these huge animals, on down to the smallest animals you can think about. He created their entire body, but he also gave them one additional thing. All these other creatures, he gave them a mind. So he kind of gave them, he made them a two-dimensional being. Here we have their body, and he have their, really their mind, right? And he formed all of these things. And even animals, you can see some have emotions when you see them. You know, if you don't ever think that's true, if you've ever had a dog and you leave the house for more than 10 seconds and you come back in, boy, they sure look at you like they miss you, and you've been gone for, you know, years and years and years, and all of a sudden, you know, their best friend has returned to them. You can see those things in them. But think about this. He got down to man and he did one thing different. He started out the same. He said he reached down to the ground. He grabbed the dirt. He formed man. Well, he wasn't just a body. He gave him a mind as well, gave him that soul component, that mind, that will, that emotions. But he did one last thing, and it ended up way differently. You know, in doing this, God really gave man a third dimension, something that, again, is non-existent in animals that were being made. But God said that we were to be made what? In his image. And if you break down and you look and say, okay, what do you mean by in his image? There's multiple things that go into that. You could say even physical form, but in spirit as well. We're talking about how God is. God is spirit, and he put in us a different component. You have God the Father, God the Son, God the Spirit. And man was body, soul, and spirit. Well, how do we know that he was spirit? He says, when he formed us out of the ground, the final thing that he did there in chapter 2, he said he came down and he breathed the breath of life into the nostrils of man. At that point, he took his own spirit and imparted that upon man. That spirit is what gave man life. It was different than the other animals. The other animals, he formed him, he gave him mind, he says, you're alive, go do your thing. But until God came down and actually breathed the breath of life into man's nostrils, he wasn't alive. He brought man to life in a different way. So think about this. How awesome it is that not only did he give him three parts, but if you look throughout this beginning first couple of chapters, he gave man a way to feed each of those parts. So here's the thing. God, again, provided for man in three different ways. And really, those three parts are from its least significant to its most is really our body is least significant, followed by our soul, which is our mind, will, and emotions, followed by our spirit, which is the most important part of our being. From the very beginning, we learned that we need to feed our body. God laid out the Garden of Eden, and he said he basically gave them an unlimited buffet. I mean, here's this huge place, all of these different plants on the ground that had seeds, all of these different trees that were producing fruit with seeds. And he says, everything here, you can eat of all of them. He said, look at everything around you. They're nourishment for you. They're meant to keep this physical thing going. And I'm giving you all of them except for one. I'm going to make one exception. That tree right over there. The one that's called the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, that one I don't want you to partake in. And by doing this, really, he put forth a test for man. And he really wanted to know and wanted man to be tested and say, hey, can you control yourself? You have all of this. You have basically the entire world in front of you. There's just that one thing that I don't want you to have. Now, as it comes to feeding your body, I remember when I was younger, things were a lot different. Well, I don't know about you, but I was one of those kids that could eat just about anything. And man, it was not a problem for me. And I had a friend back then. He was a really close friend. And I was trying to remember his name. Actually, I believe his name was called Metabolism. And let me tell you, we got along quite well, but you know, I got a little bit older and I actually had some health things and I had a surgery and apparently we parted ways at that time. And I can tell you right now, I can't do what I used to be able to do, but I still feed my body. Right? And I do it in different ways that are a little more healthy. I could tell you this too. You know, there's a lot of people, if you want to say, okay, if you're expecting me to tell you how to eat and those kind of things, no. I'm not going to do that. We're all a little bit different. And there are a lot of people that can help us with that. You know, there's nutritionists and such, and they have really good ways that they can lay out, you know, how you can eat. One thing I can tell you is that no matter what, we need to take care of all parts of our being. That God, again, even in the Garden of Eden, he laid out for man, he says, I need to make sure that you take care of all parts of your being. And he even gave them a way to eat. So again, it's important to take care of those and keep each healthy. Because if one starts to suffer, the others will suffer as well. Back to Adam for a minute. So here's the other thing. God gave him a way to eat physically. He had a way for him to feed that body. But also he gave him a way to feed his soul. Right? Talking about those mind, will, and emotions. And if you look at what God did here, after creating, you know, he created everything. He created man in his own image, gave him the mind, gave him a will to go and to do those things. Again, that was a part of the test. You think about that. But as we stated before, eat everything except for that one. That test for him was a test of will, right? Can you control this thing enough to say, will I or will I not do that? He had two out of the three parts of really even his mind, his will was taken care of, but that emotional connection wasn't there. And God said, okay, look, we've gone through all these other animals. We've gone through all these other things. And he said, wow, you know what? We need to make man a partner that's comparable to him. You know, he said, we haven't found anything that's come out of creation yet that's been comparable to man. And so God created woman and gave man that emotional connection, right? For some of you, that might bring up a bit of an emotional thing and say, well, just think about this. Though, just as the body, we're all unique. And some of you go, you know what? I've been looking for my Adam or I've been looking for my Eve. And your motivations keep you from eating from that tree. And he also gave Adam a way to engage his mind, right? Think about this. In chapter 2 of Genesis, boy, God gave him a big job. I mean, a really, really, really big job. He said, here's the thing. I'm going to make every living creature that's out there. And I'm going to engage your mind here. I'm going to keep that mind fresh. We're going to keep it going. You, Adam, get to name everything that is living. And whatever it is you call it from now until eternity, that's what's going to be that thing is going to be called. You got to think about, man, Adam had some really amazing names for things. And if you look and you name and look at names of animals, I'm going to put one right down here. You're going to see this. It's a really big name. I don't even know that I can pronounce it. But it's essentially some sort of a soldier fly kind of thing that's still more of an animal than an insect. And this is supposedly the animal with the largest name. Adam came up with that. You know, over time, I'm sure his mind got a little bit tired. That's why when we get to the very end, you get animals named like ox. You know, he kind of ran out. Maybe fly. Just started naming them for what they did. He just totally ran out of ideas. You know, and then God even threw some tests in, right? So you can imagine Adam named this one thing a duck, and he named this other thing a beaver, and then God showed him this thing that was half duck and half beaver. And he said, great. Now come up with a name for that. Well, we know it as the platypus. Well, again, each and every one of us being unique, God has a different way for us to even connect emotionally in those things. You know, we all have different interests. We all have different talents. We all have those kind of things that draw us even to like jobs. An emotional connection can come in many different forms. You know, we need to be hearing what it is that God wants us to do. We need to be hearing how God wants us to fulfill some of those things. We all have our own ideas, but we need to know what his ideas are. The third thing is really we need to feed our spirit. Oh, the most important one out of the whole thing. Here we go. And now God gave man everything. Again, feed the physical, feed the spiritual. Watch this. Genesis chapter 3, if you got your Bible there. And we're going to look at verse 8 and verse 9. And this is after man had done some things. We went out and we did what God asked us not to do. And he says, and they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord among the trees of the garden. And then the Lord God called to Adam and said to him, where are you? Verse 8, it says that they heard him walking in the garden. Now, when I read this, that tells me that this is not the first time that this has ever happened. They know this sound. It's actually, they know what's happening at that very point. You know, this even happens in our house. And, you know, my kids even know me by my walk. It's kind of weird, but it's happened. And they said, oh, hey, Dad. And I'm like, how did you know it was me versus your mom? And they said, well, we could hear you walking down the hall. We know the way you walk. We know that sound. But this can only come from a close personal relationship, right? They knew it was him. There's all sorts of animals walking around the garden. There's different things going on. There's all sorts of noises and breezes in the cool of the evening and things. There's all this other, there's even, you know, to a degree, commotion even for their day that's going on. But out of all of that, they heard one thing. What did they hear? They heard God walking in the garden. And that comes now today. Now, we don't necessarily get to do that, right? But that comes today through worship, through prayer, when we do those things where we connect to him. And in John 10:27, it says, Jesus is speaking here and he says, my sheep hear my voice and I know them and they follow me. We need to have ourselves in a place where we know his voice. When we hear him speak, we know the difference. We truly need to pay attention to all three parts of our being, and we need to be prepared to when tests come and trials come. And as we know, you go through the Bible, you see different people who were tested in different ways. And in the book of Philippians, this was so great. There was a church that was there, and there were these two ladies that were in the church, and they were amazing women. You know, Paul calls them out by name and he says, wow, he says, you two are absolutely awesome. He says, you have been behind me since the very beginning. This is one of Paul's favorite churches. This is the church in Philippi. This is the one that has always supported him no matter what he did. They sent resources to him. They sent people to help him out. This church was behind Paul 100%. And so you have these two ladies that were very, very strong figures in the church. And an argument came up between them. And they let that thing, which came into what? Peter was tested, really, his body. You think about these two were tested with what? Their minds were really tested. You know, they let something that was trivial, they let an idea or an argument get between the two of them, so much so to the point that the church almost was torn in two because of their actions. Feels a little like maybe some things that we see today. People are having arguments over things instead of seeing the problem that's actually behind. We're focused on the thing that's right here, and we let our own minds and we let our own emotions get into the way of what God is actually trying to do. And he called them out and they reconciled, and it was such an amazing thing. The best person to look at to say, how should we respond? We need to go back and we need to look at Jesus. In Matthew chapter 4, verses 1 through 11, we see that Jesus was tempted. He said that the Holy Spirit led Jesus out into the wilderness to fast for 40 days and 40 nights. And at the end of that time, he was tested by Satan. First, he drew him out and said, okay, look, Jesus, I know you're powerful. All I got to do is just say it and these rocks will become bread. Now, you got to imagine 40 days and 40 nights, if you haven't eaten, you're pretty hungry. Your body's going to want to react and say, yes, give me that food. But how did Jesus respond? He responded by saying, it is written. He went to the spiritual. It is written in the word. Whoa. Okay. Satan knew he lost round one. Takes him to round two. takes him up onto a high peak and he says, hey, you know what? I know the word says, he even uses it. He says that your foot won't even be bruised. He says, go ahead and jump off of here and God's going to send angels. You watch. He'll just send angels, you know, to make sure that you don't get hurt. And wow, what did Jesus say? No, 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 no. It is written, do not tempt the Lord your God. He came back and he says, what do you do? It was a test of will. It was a test of mind. Come on, it was a test of ego. And he says, nope, nope, nope. He says, don't tempt the Lord. Don't test the Lord. Third test, tested his spirit. And he came up and he says, look, here's everything. Satan presents it to him. He says, all you need to do is bow down and worship me. Where is your spirit going to be at? And Jesus said, no, no, it's written. You don't worship anybody but the Lord your God. He responded properly in all three of those things. We need to avoid getting stuck in the lens of just one of those perspectives. Here's the thing. Jesus didn't get stuck in any single lens. And he said, nope, I'm not going to respond in a natural way. I'm going to respond in a spiritual way. You know, here's the thing. So many right now, so many non-believers and even believers are getting stuck in natural responses to spiritual problems. Right now, if you think about Ephesians 6:12, it even tells us what the problem is. He says, for man does not wrestle against flesh and blood, but principalities and powers. So right now, there's several things that are just boiling points for people. You can say it and they'll just get there in no time flat. And if, you know, you even mention things like the election, the coronavirus, masks, fill in the blank. And I can tell you that behind it all, there's a thief that's looking to get rid of some things for you. John 10:10, what? It says, the thief comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but I come that you have life and you will have it more abundantly. And I want to encourage you today that you need to feed your whole man. Don't give the thief any pleasure in stealing from you. We need to walk out our lives just as Jesus did. When the enemy attacks you, you need to come back at him, and the word is really where your response should always be from. And when he comes to attack and he gives you fear, he says, no, 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 no. My word says, my God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power, of love, and a sound mind. Lord, help me to live in love. You know, is that not to say that some of these things, you know, that have been already mentioned aren't to be taken seriously? No, 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 most certainly not. But I'm not going to let them dictate my response. I'm going to follow and respond in the spirit. I'm going to be like Paul. When he was persecuted, here he is in a jail. What did he do? He didn't turn his back on God and try and figure out how to get out of prison. He went further into God and he continued to pray and he continued to worship and he tied himself into that. Tied up in prison, he responded that way. I'm going to be like be just like a Daniel. When I come up against something, I want to be one who prays and goes into the Lord. 21 days he changed his diet and prayed 21 straight days for an answer. And when the angel came, he finally realized what was going on. I'm sure he knew. This guy was not unfamiliar with doing spiritual battle. But after 21 days, let me tell you, that's going to test your mind a little bit. Am I really hearing right? Should I be praying about this thing? And at the end, breakthrough happened. I want to follow the one that brings life and brings it more and more abundantly. I need to feed my whole man. As if there's some of you out there that maybe you felt like this has spoken to you a little bit, and there's some things that have come up, and man, if I just step back and I take a look, how have I truly been responding? Have I been responding the way that God wants me to, or have I been responding in the flesh? And if that's you, and just say, you know what, Lord, take that away from me. Lord, let my response be your response. Let my mind work your way. Lord, let my body react the way that you want it to react. He will do it for you today. And maybe if you feel like, you know, you've overfed one part of your being, and maybe you've let the physical or the natural things start to take over in the circumstances, and just say, you know what? I need to be a bit more like Jesus. He laid out a path for us. I need to be more like Jesus and say, let me move into the spirit and not into the natural. I want to pray for you guys really quick. So right now, Heavenly Father, for each and every one out there that needs this today, oh God, that Father, maybe we have and we've seen things around us, and we've seen the circumstances, and we've seen things that are arising, and even in our own lives that causes something to stir up inside of us, where even maybe we feel like Peter and we react in the wrong way. Lord, by saying things or doing things. Father, right now, we thank you that you are a restorative God and you can take that from us and restore our position where we need to be. Father, take those things out of our lives. Father, help us to react in the right way. Father, help us to live in the proper manner. Father, help us to turn to you. Let us be like Paul, oh God, when we find ourselves pressed, that we turn deeper into you. Where we find ourselves bound, instead of trying to find our own way out, Lord, we turn to you to find our way out. We just thank you for that today. And in Jesus' name, I have one other prayer real quick that I want to do. If you have never accepted Jesus before in your life, and all of this starts with coming around with having a relationship with him. You know, that's how we can respond in the spirit when we know him. And even as Jesus said, remember we said it, my sheep, you know, hear my voice. Well, that comes from having a relationship and getting to know him. So right now, if you've never done that, or maybe you've even done that at one point in your life and felt like you've walked away and you need to come back today, pray this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I come to you today just as I am. I am a sinner in need of a Savior. And today, I invite you to come into my life and to be my Lord and Savior. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for your willingness to die for me. I accept that gift today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Life so unexplainable, I I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are.
It was such a joy to see you here and many of you commenting through the live chat. It's a great way to see you guys and seeing conversing. It adds to the fellowship depth here. And we are praying that you have a wonderful week. And we're praying favor and blessing in this new month starting on Tuesday that you will finish this year strong. Because even when we get tested and tried, we are always winners if God is on our side. During the month of December, we're going to continue with our tradition where Sarah and I speak most of the month together. And so next week will be our first week where we will speak together as a team. So we're looking forward. God's God given us a fresh word for this season that we believe is just for now. So be sure to join us. Invite your family to join us online or in person. God bless you and have a wonderful week.
Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that a God can do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that a God can do. In just one word, you heal what's broken inside. I gotta believe.
There's no power like the power of Jesus. So let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe, come on, for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power.